England, having failed to be a republic, had failed to be a monarchy. It was a bit of a puzzler. Perhaps William should declare himself king by right of conquest. He didn't think so. Parliament wanted Mary to take the crown, James's daughter, after all. But she insisted that her husband was boss, and he didn't intend to play the Duke of Edinburgh role, two paces behind the ruling lady. This short, stooping, asthmatic man with bad teeth was tough and shrewd. He was himself a grandson of Charles I and wouldn't make a humble consort. In the end, a deal was struck. They would both be sovereigns, Mr. and Mrs. King and Queen, by the invitation of Parliament. And they had to sign up to some basic rules. No standing army unless Parliament agreed to it. No raising of money without Parliament's approval. No royal power to lay down the law. The King and Queen couldn't appoint or punish judges. They couldn't make war without Parliament's consent, and Parliament would decide who could have the crown. And it wouldn't be a Roman Catholic. All the questions posed by the Civil War were finally answered, and it was called the Glorious Revolution, because in the end, the whole basis of royal power was redefined without anyone being killed at all. Except in Ireland, of course. James, with French backing, decided to make a comeback through Ireland. It was, after all, one part of Britain where a Catholic king could expect some enthusiasm. Protestant settlers had been brought into Ulster, and they held Londonderry and Enniskillen against the Catholic regiments. Eventually, in 1690, there was a showdown between William's Anglo-Dutch-Danish army and James's Franco-Irish one at the River Boyne. James was beaten in a battle which has cast a grotesquely long shadow over Ulster. The annual celebration there of the Protestant victory has never lost its 17th century passion. The irony is that this was not a religious war at all. It was a war to contain the ambitions of France, and the Pope was actually firmly on the side of William of Orange. The Vatican was more anti-French than it was anti-Protestant. The Orange men at the Battle of the Boyne were actually fighting for the Pope as well as King Billy. And Billy, of course, was not exactly English. His native tongue was Dutch. William, a serious man, ended up spending much of his time on the continent, so in effect Mary did become the sovereign of England. But at the end of 1694, she died of smallpox. England was now in effect ruled by an oligarchy through Parliament. The king had a role, but by no means a commanding one. Part of that role, as he saw it, was to push forward religious tolerance in a fundamentally intolerant country. Another part was to smash the French, who were obviously a danger to everyone and everything. Tolerance does have its limits. At his death in 1702, the question of the succession had already been agreed and settled. The crown passed to Mary's sister Anne.